Thank you and good afternoon. Let me start my talk with a brief apology for changing the... Is this on? With a brief apology for changing the title, Dr. Ranchal was supposed to give the talk on this, combining this with zero energy, net zero energy buildings, and I thought I'd leave that specific topic to him and focus a little more on the generalities of physics informed neural networks and how we can really mix it up with CFD. Okay. So I will basically say why we got into this, or rather what led us to jump into this. Then I will speak a little more on this one. Then I will, you know, because this workshop has to do with energy, so I should say something about heat transfer and all that. If time permits, I'll also talk a little about digital twin, which is another interesting area that's coming up. And then, of course, the usual summary. So the motivating example which led us into machine learning and neural networks and so on was basically the problem of filling a radiator with coolant. And what led the client to come to us was when you fill the radiator with coolant, there are air bubbles trapped in the coolant. You know, it's usually a mixture of ethylene glycol, water, and some other things. And these air bubbles, they spread through the system during operations and they reduce the thermal performance of the system. I'm sorry I have to give you generic pictures because the originals are, I'll be in trouble if I disclose the original geometry. But you can see a fairly complex systems of tubes and several circuits, pumps, and radiators with a lot of little fin tubes and so on. And of course, it's no surprise that when you fill it, there are air bubbles trapped in the system. And we went and saw the experiment that was actually being done by the client. It's in Bangalore. And you can see that, after you fill the system with coolant, they turn on the pump, and when they turn on the pump, the entire thing, they had a transparent window, in a couple of places, the whole thing turns a milky white color because of the presence of air. And that's extremely detrimental to the performance of the system. And, this is where from I took this image, but you can see it's more or less a complicated system of tubes, reservoirs, pumps, and radiators, and all that. Okay. Now, what the client, they were already trying CFD. They were doing 3D unsteady Navier-Stokes plus volume of fluid to simulate the entire filling process. And also, they had not yet got to the stage of operating the pump yet. They were just trying to fill the entire system with fluid and prime the pump. And it was taking a tremendously long time. They have several of these little tubes and all that, more than 100, I think, if I remember correctly. And you have VOF, volume of fluid approach, which is very resource intensive, and the time step is limited by the Courant number. So on a cluster, they have good resources, obviously. And on a cluster, each simulation was taking from 2 to 3 months. So basically, it was a complete showstopper. They were ready to... they had actually already given up on CFD, and they were just saying, okay, let's try it and see if it works. So that is... that's where they were when they approached me to see whether I could speed up the case. And obviously, if I try the same thing, I can't do much better. Maybe I can fine-tune the thing, maybe bring it down from 3 months to 2.5 months, but I can't do better than that. The technique itself has got its own limits. So I had to look for something that at least models some of the less critical parts. And, my initial idea was, you have these thin long tubes in the radiator part. And by looking at the experiment, some of these were transparent. I could see all the tubes were completely filled with the coolant. There was no air trapped there. And the, you know, the solution is likely to be fully developed in these thin, long tubes. You know, it's pretty much one-dimensional with fully developed flow once it is full. Probably there are some local effects near the air-water interface, but we don't really care about that, right? So I want to try a reduced order model for the tubes and then mix it up with finite volumes in the rest of the flow field. So let us see where that got us. So basically, first I tried some of the projection-based reduced order models. So model order reduction, I start from, I isolated a single tube and did high fidelity volume of fluid simulations for that, you know, with very fine mesh. And then either a pivot, actually, these are just, I started with POD, but I quickly gave it up. I went for dynamic mode decomposition, DMD. Okay, so as an interesting aside, POD is actually many decades old. Professor Radham Narasimhan wrote an article saying this gentleman from the Indian, published in the Journal of Indian Mathematical Society in 1943. It has been reinvented in many forms in many other fields under different names, but I thought it's interesting that an Indian was the first known person to publish this method. Okay, anyway, to cut a long story short, I tried dynamic mode decomposition based on the generated CFD simulation. And then I plugged it into finite volume. And I used open form for that rather than our own code answer. I used open form because the original libraries were in C++. It was easier to put them together in open form. Whereas I would have to translate them into Fortran to mix it with the answer. Now, after trying for a couple of months, I gave up on that. Didn't work very well. When you put it to, you know, the individual components were fine. The DMD reproduced the solutions fine. But somehow it did not interface too well with the finite volume in the rest of the system. And, you know, my suspicion is the pressures computed by DMD did not, you know, gave finite volume and indigestion. You know, mass balance was going haywire. So after a couple of months, I gave up on that. And then I examined the artificial neural network for that. You know, so basically, again, the concept remains the same. All the thin tubes are to be replaced with an artificial, you know, neural network. So now this is actually more interesting. It got me better traction. This is a decades-old technology that suddenly got interesting around 2012. You know, I had back in the early 90s, I had roommates who were doing neural networks for handwriting recognition, and they were getting really miserable results, and we used to laugh at them. Finally, he gave up in frustration and moved to something else. But theoretically, mathematically speaking, it's a universal function approximator. If you have a neural network with a sufficiently large number of units, then you can approximate any reasonably well-behaved function. You know, the only problem with that, and which is the reason why it did not work too well in the earlier decades, it needs a lot of data for training. The deeper it is, the more data you need. Otherwise, it'll overfit the, you know, training points. And then, of course, that means it needs significant computing resources for training, which was not available in those days. The nice part is the evaluation of a neural network is very rapid. You can plug it into your browser and you can do it in real time. You know, it's a training that really is the killer here. Okay, so now probably for the benefit of those who are not very familiar with this, since most of us are CFD people, neural network consists of, this is basically a directed graph, acyclic graph. And you have an input layer, which is basically the inputs of your problem, and they are connected to certain hidden layers, one or more hidden layers, and then it does certain calculations and it goes to an output layer, and then you pick up your outputs and do what you will with that. So this is basically a schematic which shows one input layer, one hidden layer, and one output layer, and this is also known as a multi-layer perceptron. So it basically forms a computational graph, and I'll go into the mathematics in the next one. So what you have is these connections here, they carry certain weights. So the output of the first one gets multiplied by a certain weight plus a certain bias, gets a linear transformation basically, and followed by a nonlinear activation goes into the next layer. So that becomes, so that's what this describes. You have basically a matrix multiplication, a matrix of weights followed by an activation vector from the previous layer plus a certain bias. Now the whole thing gets element wise reduced or activated by a nonlinearity. Need not necessarily be hyperbolic time, can be any nonlinearity, goes to the next one. And then each layer forms a composition of these nonlinearities. So that's why it can fit. This nonlinearity is essential for the network to really work. Okay. So basically, you have all these linear transformations followed by a nonlinear activation. And the nonlinear activation can be hyperbolic tan, as I put here, or a sigmoid, rectified linear unit, leaky rectified linear unit. And here I have highlighted custom activations, which is what, you know, we will mention why it is later. Okay. Now the weights and biases, the W's and the B's, numbers, how do you obtain them? There is no theory for that. So you obtain them by an optimization procedure, or also called training. Basically, you fit them to known examples. So you can, for example, use CFD to generate certain cases, high fidelity results. You have inputs, outputs, and then you train the network to fit a whole bunch of examples. And the optimization procedure minimizes a cost function, and using some gradient descent or some more advanced variant of that. So this is the time consuming part, fitting the function using an optimization procedure to known examples. And the deeper you have a neural network, more examples you really need to make sure it functions well. And that's the actual time consuming part, the optimization. Now, how do you get the gradients? First of all, you make sure your activation functions are differentiable. The entire network should be fully differentiable. And you go backwards from the output and compute the gradients of the weights with respect to the cost function using the chain rule. So you go back along the network, back from the output, back towards the input, and at each layer, you apply the chain rule of the activations with respect to the previous activations. And that's how you get the back propagation. And the cost functions are typically the mean squared error plus a few regularization terms, and this I will talk about in a little bit of detail in the next one. Okay. Now, probably your computer science friends have been telling you, or your AI friends have been telling you, that you no longer need physics, or you no longer need any domain. You have a lot of data, you can fit your machine learning model to that. So somebody actually published, wrote a paper saying the end of theory. Okay. And you can just go with data. That's not really true in our case, at least. How do you generate that kind of volumes of data, you know, fluid mechanics and CFD data required to train a neural network? You can't really do that. So this is actually a relatively new concept, about 2 years old. You take any general artificial neural network as we described earlier. So the inputs are your boundary conditions, initial conditions, fluid properties. Outputs are your flow variables. And then you add one or more layers that actually compute the residuals of the Navier-Stokes or any other equations from these. Okay. And these residuals, you want to obviously drive them close to zero as possible, or minimize them. So you just add the sum of them to the cost function, and then you minimize the whole thing with respect to the weights. How am I doing for time? Okay. So you modify the neural network to obey conservation laws. And these are the three key papers. If you want to, I'll leave the presentation, or you can write to me. I can send you these papers, or I can send you other references. Anyway, this is a very rapidly evolving field. So these people are from Brown University. They introduced the concept of the physics-informed neural network. Okay. And then the other interesting work is being done by Balaji Srinivasan at IIT Madras, Department of Mechanical Engineering. And he has introduced a concept whereby you have several of these units coupled together, and then he reduces a composite cost function to get the entire thing. So that's the thing. Now the third key paper is something that I personally like very much. Rather than adding stuff to the cost function, he actually changes the structure of the network. He actually changes the structure of the network so that it outputs the different terms in the Navier-Stokes equations, and also enforces any inequality constraints. For example, temperature should be always greater than zero. Your K and epsilon and other scalars should be always positive, and so on. So those kind of constraints also can be added to the overall network using this method. So it's called enforcing analytic constraints in the, and that's where the custom activations that I mentioned come in. You write custom activation functions and freeze the weights to one, and then you can backpropagate to learn the weights. Okay. So basically the summary is here, not only it learns from the data, but it also has knowledge of the physics. And then these solution gradients are obtained by automatic differentiation, that is backpropagating the derivatives using the chain rule across the network. So it's not numerical differentiation. It's actually because the function is known and consists of a computational graph, you can go backwards along the graph applying the chain rule and get the actual derivatives. So what are the advantages? One is you can understand your results a lot better, and you can explain them better. And engineers and designers generally have better confidence in the results if it is less of a black box. You know, general machine learning is a black box. You don't know what's going on inside that. And this also turns out that it's more robust when evaluated outside its training set. So it doesn't really need big data. You can work with small data. And you can also work with no data. You can drop all the data and you can just reduce the residuals of the Navier-Stokes. Then you effectively have a meshless method for solving the Navier-Stokes equations. You know, because you're evaluating it at isolated points, so in all senses it can be thought of as a meshless method if you are. But unlike a regular meshless method, you can augment it with very high fidelity training data, and then you get more accurate results. And the best part is it learns with backpropagation. It learns, the more examples you present, the more cases you do, the better it gets. So next time it gets you more accurate results in one pass. You know, that is the attractive part of this. Okay. And specifically for unsteady problems, we use the long short-term memory network. So this is an artificial neural network that is augmented with state. So it has a state vector which also gets modified with the time step. So it's very good for, useful for unsteady problems, you know, where you march in time. Same sort of concept is used for natural language processing, human language translation, and so on, or for processing videos. So this was quite useful for unsteady problems, which is what we had in our case, right? So I replaced the tubes with LSTM, one LSTM for each tube. I trained them using isolated CFD for each tube. Then I embedded it inside the finite volume code. The physics-informed neural network and finite volume, they exchange data at every iteration and every time step. They exchange flow parameters, the fraction or volume of fluid in each cell, the pressure, you know, and so on. And then, you have reduced the mesh. You have dropped all the mesh points inside the tubes. So you have saved a lot of mesh points. Automatically, you get a significant improvement in the speed. And we also found that the air-water interface is a little bit diffused compared to finite volume. But since that is really not of interest here, we just want to make sure there is no air sitting inside the tubes at the end of the process. So that was okay, we could live with that. It gave fairly good flow resolution, but. So a similar example was, is still ongoing, but I just thought I would share some details with you. This is also a very good candidate for this kind of replacement. You have long tubes, excuse me, and people have in the past used porosity approaches and so on to model all these, you know, hundreds of tubes sitting inside a shell and tube heat exchanger. Or you have to go for very high, very high mesh resolution. So here we took a slightly different approach. We use what is called a convolutional neural network. Each tube was replaced by a convolutional neural network. Okay, and the convolutional neural network. Okay, this is the convolutional neural network called AlexNet that really started it off. You know, in 2012, they won some ImageNet competition, which gave them much better results on handwriting recognition than any other known method at that point. So that's what really sparked off the revolution in AI, if you can call it that. So here, I don't want to go into the full details of this. It's enough that if you have your input data, you don't connect every input with every neuron in the next layer. Okay, you localize it so that you achieve a sparse matrix, a sparse linear transform rather than a full matrix. Because if you have so many layers and you have dense matrices, you will run out of RAM. So you use these, and then of course everything else works the same way. So you have shared weights, local filters, and then sparsity. And we are using a 3D CNN for the 3D steady state problem. And one additional advantage of this localization of parameters, or rather shared resources and local filters, is you also get for free translational invariance. 10 minutes? We have 10, 5 minutes? Okay. So you get, you know, okay, that's fine. So basically you can cut down again the same process. You cut down the number of mesh points, and you can basically get computation still ongoing, so I'm not showing it any results from this. And digital twin, I think I'll skip, given that, you know, we're running out of time. And about companies, ACRI and CFD-BRI, you can contact me if you are interested in more details about these techniques. And this is a summary, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Matuka. And time for questions. Any questions? Wow, very clear explanation, right? And very informative talk.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Matuka.